Well, thank you for joining us for Almost Persuaded. My name is Alan Hall, the pastor of Good News Free Will Baptist Church in York, Pennsylvania. If you have your Bibles today, if you'll turn to Acts chapter 15, Acts chapter 15, and we'll read the first several verses together. I'd like to speak to you on the subject today of what does it take to be saved? What does it take to be saved? Verse 1 of Acts chapter 15 says, "And certain men which came down from Judea taught the brethren and said, Except ye be circumcised after the manner of Moses, ye cannot be saved. When therefore Paul and Barnabas had no small dissension and disputation with them, they determined that Paul and Barnabas and certain other of them should go up to Jerusalem unto the apostles and elders about this question. And being brought on their way by the church, they passed through Phoenicia and Samaria, declaring the conversion of the Gentiles, and they caused great joy unto all the brethren. And when they were come to Jerusalem, they were received of the church and of the apostles and elders, and they declared all things that God had done with them. But there rose up certain of the sect of the Pharisees which believed, saying that it was needful to circumcise them and to command them to keep the law of Moses. And the apostles and elders came together for to consider of this matter. And when there had been much disputing, Peter rose up and said unto them, Men and brethren, ye know how that a good while ago God made choice among us, that the Gentiles by my mouth should hear the word of the gospel and believe. And God, which knoweth the hearts, bear them witness, giving them the Holy Ghost, even as he did unto us, and put no difference between us and them, purifying their hearts by faith. Now therefore, why tempt ye God to put a yoke upon the neck of the disciples, which neither our fathers nor we were able to bear? But we believe that through the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, we shall be saved even as they." You know, if someone were to walk up to you, you were walking down the street, and they were to come up to you and ask you just out of the blue, "What must I do to be saved? How can I be saved?" What would you say? Would you know how to answer that question? Now, that's not a small question, is it? Because your answer, your correct answer to that question will greatly determine where that person spends eternity. Now, here in our text, Paul and Barnabas, as we've just read, had just returned from one of their, the first missionary journey. They had taken the gospel to the Gentiles and basically to anybody who would listen. Every place that God would allow them to go, they went preaching the gospel. And of course, we find out here that many people were saved because of their effort. But then we find in this passage that some of the men, some Pharisees from Judea, said to these new converts of Paul and Barnabas, they said to them, "You're not really saved. Now, you think you're saved, but you're not really saved, because in order for you to really be saved, then you've got to become a Jewish proselyte. You've got to go through our rituals. You've got to keep the commandments, the law of Moses." And in other words, they were saying that in order to get into the house of faith, these folks had to go through the door of Judaism. Now, of course, this disturbed the folks, and it greatly confused many of them. And so what they decided to do was to send Paul and Barnabas, and it says some others, down to Jerusalem to talk to the apostles, to the leaders of the church there, to find out what does it take to be saved? What does it take to be born again? And it was there that these church leaders got together to discuss the matter. It was there that the apostle Peter stood up and he said, "Hey, look, we're Jews. All of us here are Jews, and we know and understand what Judaism is. But that has nothing whatsoever to do with being saved." Now, what these Pharisees were trying to do here was to pollute the gospel. Now, today we have air pollution, we have water pollution, we have noise pollution, we even have mind pollution today, but none of these are as bad as gospel pollution. And it was going on in the early church's day, and it's still going on today. You see, the old devil, he knows that most folks desire to know the truth. I mean, don't you want to know what's right? Don't you want to know? Nobody wants to live a lie. No, nobody wants folks lying to them all the time. Most folks desire to hear and to know the truth. And the devil knows that. And so what he does, he doesn't mind us knowing the truth as long as we'll buy into some of the poison that he injects inside that truth. If we'll buy into some of the lies and to the bending of truth and the confusing of truth that he is so good and so subtle at doing, then he's fine with us knowing a little bit of that truth because it gets us off course just a little bit. And that satisfies him, okay? And so I'm glad these disciples, these church leaders got together. I'm glad that they nailed it down once and for all what it takes to be saved because there is much confusion about that matter today. There's a lot of different beliefs out there what it takes to be saved. But notice what Peter says down again in verse 11. It says, "But we believe that through the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, we shall be saved, even as they." That means that every person who is truly saved, that's back then in Peter's day, that is right now during our day, every person that's truly saved is saved in the same way, by grace through faith, plus nothing, minus nothing. And it doesn't matter if you're a Jew or Gentile or white or black or if you're rich or poor, if you're truly saved, then you are saved by grace through faith in Jesus Christ. Now, we can take all the churches of our area, all the churches that are around your area, and we can take every single one of those churches and we can put them into two groups. On the right hand, you have the group of churches that believe, for by grace are you saved through faith, that Jesus is the only way. It is only by putting our faith and trust in Him that we can be saved. And then you have the other group of churches which said, yeah, faith is important, but faith is the beginning point. It's the starting point. Because after faith, then you've got to prove your faith. You've got to do this, that, and the other. In other words, you have to add things to your faith. Well, the Bible's very clear about what salvation means and what it takes to be saved. And so I want us to look at three truths about this salvation. Salvation that only comes through Jesus Christ today. First of all, salvation is imperative. It's not optional. It's imperative, not optional. Now, why is salvation imperative? Well, look back at the words in verse 9 again. It says, "And put no difference." You see those two words? "No difference between us and them, purifying their hearts by faith." Now, turn over, if you would, to Romans. That's the next book over in your Bible. Romans chapter 3, a very important chapter in the Bible. Romans chapter 3, and look down in verse 22. It says, "Even the righteousness of God, which is," listen, "by faith of Jesus Christ unto all and upon all them that believe." And here come those two words again. "For there is no difference, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God." You see, all of us, there is no difference. All of us have the same problem. We have the sin problem. And the idea that there are good people and that there are bad people is a notion that only exists in the minds of men. You don't find that in the Bible, that there are good people and there are bad people. Think about it. We think about terrorists. Now, terrorists are evil people, right? They're bad people. And so we'll put them over here in this category, and then we'll go and we'll look at ourselves in the mirror and we'll say, you know what? I'm a pretty good person. I mean, compared to them. We'll take folks like abortionists and murderers and child abusers, and we'll lump all of those folks in one category, and we'll say, wow, they're bad people. And then again, we look at ourselves or look at someone close to us, and we'll say, well, we're not so bad, or they're not so bad. Matter of fact, we're pretty good. But if you go back to the book of Romans, Romans chapter 1, it says that all bad people are sinners. All bad people need to be saved. And most of us would say amen to that, right? We believe that bad people need to be saved in order to get to heaven. But then you come to Romans chapter 2. And Romans chapter 2 says, listen, good people need to be saved. And so you have bad people needing to be saved and good people needing to be saved. And then you come to chapter 3 and it tells us that religious people need to be saved. And then you come to these verses 22 and 23, which tells us that there's no difference, that all men need to be saved. You see, the devil, he doesn't want us to believe that truth. He doesn't want you believing that today, that all of us need to be saved. Matter of fact, he works overtime to convince the world that even some Christians he convinces that good people will go to heaven one day and bad people will go to hell. But you know what? That's not completely true, is it? There is no difference. The man who lusts after women is no different than the man who commits the act of adultery with them. The person who robs a store at gunpoint is no worse in God's eyes than a person who cheats on his time card at work or a person who cheats on his taxes at the end of the year. Sin is sin, and every single one of us is guilty of sin before God. There is no difference. Many years ago, back when cameras first came out and it was a big deal to have your picture taken, there was a preacher that was walking along a beach, and he was carrying his Bible in a leather pouch. And he was basically looking for a place to sit down, a place that was quiet and peaceful, that he could just open up God's Word and just spend some time alone there with God. But before he could sit down, there was a group of teenagers there that day on the beach also, and they saw his leather pouch, and they thought there was a camera inside. And so they come running up to this preacher and they said, "Hey, can you take our picture? Come on, please take our picture." And so they were all excited about it. And so the preacher was just kind of played along a little bit. And he says, "Well, I already have your picture." And they said, "Well, we didn't see you take our picture. What do you mean?" He says, "Well, I didn't take your picture. God took your picture." And they said, "We don't understand. Can you explain?" And so he opened his Bible and he turned to this passage, Romans chapter 3, verse 23. And he says, "For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God." You see, it doesn't matter who you are and what you've done, you're in that picture. There is no difference. Now, that's the bad news. Let me give you the good news. Turn over to Romans chapter 10. Romans chapter 10, same book. Just a couple of chapters later, Romans chapter 10, and look down in verse 12. Here's those words again. "For there is no difference between the Jew and the Greek. For the same Lord over all is rich unto all that call upon Him. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." Jesus satisfied the holy demands of our Heavenly Father with His perfect life. And He satisfied our sin debt with His sacrificial death. And can you imagine, while He was hanging there on the cross, He reached up and took the hand of a holy God. And He reached down to grab the hand of sinful man, and He brought our hands together. He reconciled us. There was a great gulf between us. There was no way of reconciling us back with God. There was such a separation there that you and I couldn't do anything about it. But Jesus did something about it. He hung there between heaven and earth, and He bridged that gap for us. And He joins our hands. He became our mediator between us and God. And if you want to be saved today, you shouldn't go through the Baptist door, or the Catholic door, or the Presbyterian door, or the Christian door. No, there's only one door that you must go through, and that is the door of Jesus Christ. And by the way, I didn't say that. He is the one who said that. He said, "I am the way, the truth, the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by Me." Now, Jesus is not a good way to heaven. And He's not a better way to heaven. And He's not even the best way to heaven. He is the only way to heaven. So first of all, salvation is imperative. It's not optional. Secondly, salvation is about the inward, not the outward. Back in our text in verse 5, the Pharisees here were doing what a lot of people try to do today. That is, they were taking something that was an outward thing and trying to make it an inward reality. In this passage of Scripture, they were using circumcision. Let me use an illustration from our day. Baptism. Baptism is a wonderful, beautiful symbol outwardly of something that's happened inwardly. But it doesn't do anything for you inwardly. I mean, how in the world can baptism wash away your sin? I mean, you gonna pour it in your ear or drink it down? I mean, how is it going to get in there to clean out all that sin? It can't. Baptism can't wash away your sin. I love that hymn we sing in church. What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. There is no other fount I know. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Folks, we'll try all kinds of outward things today to make an inward change. But you know what? It's all in vain. Those outward things do nothing for you inwardly. Some will try being a good church member. And they'll say, you know what? If I can be a really good church member, then maybe somehow I'll be good enough. God will let me in. No, it won't work. It's in vain. Some folks will try taking communion. Some folks will try to do charitable work or giving a good donation, or maybe like the rich young ruler in the New Testament where he came to Jesus and he claimed he had kept all the commandments from his youth up. You know what? If I can keep God's commandments good enough, then maybe I'll be good enough. Maybe I'll be a good person enough in God's eyes. No, none of these things will save your soul. It's by grace alone, through faith alone, in Christ alone. You know, I love that acrostic that I learned many years ago, faith. You take the first letter of as you go through that word faith, and it stands forsaking all, I trust Him. That's what faith is. It has nothing to do with us. It's nothing to do with what this world can offer us and being good enough and doing enough. No, it's putting our faith and trust in Him, believing that through His blood He can save us from our sins. You know, I've heard some folks say, well, that's a narrow-minded way of thinking. We're all going to heaven. We're just taking different roads. And I mean, all that matters is that we're sincere, right? You know, it's kind of funny how some folks are so open-minded when it comes to salvation, but not in other areas of their lives. Let me give you an example. You know, when I go to a drugstore, I don't want an open-minded pharmacist, do you? You know, that pharmacist, he can go back there and he can say, you know what, I've got some pills here and I've got some pills here, and you know what, we can mix these together, and it really doesn't matter what's on your prescription, you know, I can just put it all together, and you know, it'll all be good, because, I mean, I'm being sincere in what I'm doing. You'd never go to a druggist like that, a pharmacist. You'd say, no, he's going to kill me. No, you want a pharmacist that believes in right and wrong. You want a pharmacist that draws the line and saying, you know what, this is dangerous and this is helpful and understands reality. You don't want a pharmacist off in dream world somewhere thinking that everything's going to work out in the end. No, you want a narrow-minded pharmacist. You know, when I go to the bank, I don't want a open-minded banker. You know, if I go to the bank and I deposit in $100, you know, I want a receipt back that says that I deposited $100. I mean, isn't that the kind of banker that you want? You don't want a banker to come back and say to you, well, you know what, I know you deposited $100 in there, but really it doesn't matter what's on this receipt. And I mean, numbers are just numbers, and we'll just make sure that it all comes out in the end some way. And, you know, as long as we're in the ballpark, as long as we're in the neighborhood, it'll be okay. No, I want a narrow-minded banker, a narrow-minded pharmacist to understand, you know, that there is a right and wrong way of looking at things. Well, you know what? There is a right and wrong way of looking at what the Bible says about salvation is, what it means as well. I mean, you think about all the ideas that's out there, all the theories of what it takes to get you to heaven. All of these things cannot be right. All the religions in the world cannot be right. You say, how can you say that? Well, if you'll look at the world's religions, you'll find out that they're all fundamentally different. But what the devil has most people believing through all these many different religions is that salvation depends on what I do instead of what God does. But the Bible says and teaches us very clearly, very plainly, that salvation is not by doing, it is by believing. It is not by trying, it is by trusting in Jesus Christ. So number one, salvation is imperative. It's not optional. Number two, salvation is inward. It's not outward. Number three, salvation is freely given. It's not something that's earned. Back in our text, notice again in verse 11, "For we believe that through the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ we shall be saved, even as they." You see that word grace? Grace is so important because it speaks here of salvation. Grace is defined in the dictionary as unmerited favor. In other words, it's receiving something that you absolutely, positively do not deserve. Do any of us deserve salvation? Absolutely not. And you can't do enough to deserve salvation. If we could do anything to merit salvation, then the Bible says that Jesus died in vain. In other words, He shed His blood, He hung on the cross, He laid His life down, He died for us, for the world, in vain. If we could do anything to even help salvation, then salvation would be in part dependent on us, right? Instead of being all about Jesus. Let me show you the difference. I could say, if I had a dollar today, I could hold it up in front of you and I'd say, "Hey, do you want this dollar? I mean, you can have it. Look, I'm giving you this dollar. It is a gift. All you have to do is reach out and take it. It is a free gift for you. You don't have to do anything. You don't have to be smart. You don't have to do anything for me. It is yours. It is a free gift." Now, you know what? That's what salvation is. Salvation is a gift of God. "For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son." It is a gift. We don't have to do anything for it. Now, what if I took the same dollar and I held it out to you and I said, "You know what? I'm going to give you this dollar. It's yours. It's not going to cost you anything to get this dollar. All you have to do is reach out and take it. But once you reach out and take it now, there is a condition. I want you to shine my shoes. Can you do that for me?" Now, what am I doing? I'm putting a condition on salvation. I'm saying, yes, it is a free gift, but at the same time, I'm saying that it's not a free gift, that you have to do something in order to earn that dollar. Now, that's the way a lot of people look at salvation. Yes, it is a free gift from God. It's through Jesus. I can only go through Him. But then they say, "You know what? I've got to do something else. I've got to be baptized. I've got to be good enough. I've got to go to church. I've got to read my Bible. Now, all those are good things, but we're not earning our way to get to heaven. We can't earn our way to get there. It is a free gift. During the Spanish-American War, there was a young colonel by the name of Teddy Roosevelt. You ever heard of him? Pretty popular fellow, isn't he? Teddy Roosevelt had a group of men at that time that they called them the Rough Riders. And he had several of his men that were injured. They needed some medical attention. Most of his men were hungry. They didn't have the food that was necessary to feed them. But Teddy Roosevelt heard about a lady by the name of Clara Barton. At that time, Clara Barton was starting up an organization, a movement called the Red Cross. And they basically helped people, helped those that were in need. And so Teddy Roosevelt heard about Clara Barton. He heard about the Red Cross. And so he went to Clara and he says, "My men need help. They're hungry. They need food. Some of them are wounded. They need medical supplies. Look, I want to buy what we need in order to help them." And she said, "No, I can't help you." And he said, "What?" He said, "Look, I've got the money. I'll pay for it out of my own pocket if you'll just let me get the medical supplies and the food that we need to help these guys. They're in need. Can't you help us?" And she said, "No." And she turned him away. Well, Teddy Roosevelt couldn't believe this, and so he went into town and he was asking around different folks. And he was perplexed about the whole thing. "Why won't she help me? She helps these other folks." And finally, somebody said to Teddy, they said, "Just ask her. Just ask for the help." And so a smile came across his face because then he realized what had taken place. You see, he had basically insulted Clara Barton by wanting to buy something that was free. You see, he was trying to put a price on love, and you can't do that. It was a gift of love, and she wanted to give it to him freely. And for him to want to pay for it was just an insult. You know what? I believe folks insult God all the time by trying to earn heaven. You know, all the money in the world couldn't purchase it anyway. And all the good that a person can do could never be enough to deserve heaven. Why? Because there is no difference. We're all sinners. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. So, a person shouldn't wait to be saved. I mean, knowing this truth, a person shouldn't wait to be saved, as some people do, because some people do, and maybe you've heard folks say this, well, I know I need to be saved, but I want to clean up my life first. You know, if you do that, then that person's not going to get saved. Because if a person does that, then they're not going to be trusting in Christ, are they? They're going to be trusting in themselves. Besides, that's kind of putting the cart before the horse, isn't it? I mean, you wouldn't say, I'm sick, and so I'm going to get better and then go to the doctor, right? I mean, we wouldn't dare do that. No, you got to go to the doctor first. Well, that's the way we're saved. We go to Jesus, the great physician. Let Him heal us. Let Him clean us. Let Him make us well. And then He works on helping us clean up our life. Can I ask you today, are you saved? Are you truly saved? Are you 100% sure that you've been born again? You know, salvation is imperative. It's not an optional thing. If you're going to get to heaven, you've got to go through the door of Jesus Christ. Salvation is something that happens inwardly, not outwardly. You can't hang on to something that's symbolic like baptism or church membership or communion to get you to heaven. And then it's a free gift. Salvation is a free gift. You can't earn it. Why not accept God's free gift of salvation today? If you are saved, then how are you doing in sharing this truth with salvation with others? You know, God places people in our life all the time. How are you doing in sharing the gospel with them? You know, the Apostle Peter gives us this command as Christians. He says, be sober. In other words, be serious. This is a serious thing. Be sober. Be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, walketh about seeking whom he may devour. Folks, if we don't reach people with the gospel, then the devil, Peter said, will devour people. He'll tear people's lives apart, and he loves nothing more than to do that. So why not be doing everything that we can to reach people with the gospel? What does it take to be saved? For by grace are ye saved through faith, and through Christ. There's no other way. He's the only way. Have you accepted Him today?